The first Jewish revolt against Rome from AD 66 to 73 resulted in the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem and ended with the deaths of the last holdouts on Masada. The defeat was a massive blow to Messianic Jews who had rejected Jesus as the Messiah, but who were still looking for a leader sent by God to restore the independence of the Jewish nation. In AD 132, Roman officials decided to build a new city on the ruins of Jerusalem, complete with a temple to Jupiter on the Temple Mount. The attempt to build a pagan temple on holy ground aroused Jewish nationalism, leading Simon Bar Kokhba to lead a revolt against Rome, which briefly led to hopes that the Messianic Age had begun. Initial victories over the Roman army established an independent state of Israel over most of the province of Judea for over 2 years. Bar Kokhba took the title of Nasi, that is prince, and was regarded by many in Judea as the Messiah. The Roman Emperor Hadrian responded, however, with overwhelming force. He brought over 6 legions from all over the empire to Palestine. He crushed the revolt, killing Bar Kokhba, causing the deaths in the process of nearly 600,000 Jews. Hadrian then prohibited the Torah law, the Hebrew calendar. He sought out and executed Judaic scholars, and he forbid Jews to enter Jerusalem, where he went on to complete the building of a statue to Jupiter, and of course one to himself for good measure. After that revolt, from that point until 1948 and after, the Jews were a minority in Judea. Later, the Talmud would refer to Bar Kokhba, who everybody thought was the hero, as Ben Kosiba, which is a derogatory term used to indicate that he was a false messiah. The Bar Kokhba revolt, even after the devastation caused by the Romans during the first revolt 60 years earlier, shows the power of Jewish nationalism and messianic fervor that existed both before and after the time of Christ. That anticipation and expectation was fueled by passages from the prophets, like our final text today from the prophet Malachi. So we're going to be looking at Malachi 4, the first 6 verses, which is the end of the book. So starting in verse 1, it says this: "Surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and that day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them." Malachi begins by quoting God as saying, "Surely the day is coming." Nearly every culture and nearly every religion has an explanation about how this world and its people came to be. And most of them also have a prediction about how it will all come to an end. For most of them, the ending involves a day or a time of judgment, where those who have done what is right, however that is defined in that culture or religion, will be rewarded, and whoever has done what is wrong, again, however they've defined it, will be punished. So why do most cultures and religions, most of whom don't have the divine revelation that was given to the people of God, why do they still agree that this world will one day end in a spectacular and complete final judgment? Why is that idea so prevalent? I think it's pretty simple. People can't imagine this world continuing indefinitely the way it is. There is too much evil and too much injustice. It would be entirely too depressing to think that evil will never be punished and righteousness will never be rewarded. Without a final judgment in which some form of justice prevails, there isn't much left for humanity here and now other than cynicism or fatalism. But we are told by the prophet that the day is coming. The assumption of many of our ancestors was correct. There will be a day when justice prevails. God has promised to bring that day about. Two key questions remain. When will that day come? And what will that day look like? We begin with the second question. It will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant, every evildoer will be stubble, and that day is coming, will set them on fire. The most common way in which the final judgment is described in the scriptures is with fire. Over the centuries, there have been arguments about whether or not that fire in question is literal or metaphorical, but the answer to that question really doesn't matter. Whether literally or metaphorically, the arrogant and evildoers will be on the receiving end of divine justice. Justice unlike anything that has ever come before. As devastating as Sodom and Gomorrah, as obviously divine in its origin as the plagues upon Egypt, and even more final than the flood of Noah. The details of how this will unfold and what exactly it will entail are forever intriguing. People want to know those answers. But in the end, they're ultimately unimportant. The key thing to take away from the word of the Lord here is the certainty that it will one day be the day of the Lord, the day of his righteous justice. And on that day, not a root or a branch will be left to them. I'm tempted to say not a root. Root, that's one of those words that, depending on where you're from. Unlike any past instances of God's wrath, whether against his own disobedient covenant people or against humanity that is in continuing rebellion against him, this final day of the Lord will leave no wickedness behind. No rebellion uncrushed, nothing that is not in submission to the will of God. Thus, anyone or anything that thinks it will somehow escape God's notice or avoid his justice is sadly mistaken. You see, rebellion against God is a losing proposition. Its time is running out, its days are numbered. On that great and dreadful day, the wicked will face God's unprecedented wrath. But what of the righteous? What will happen to them? Verse 2 talks about that. Let's read verse 2. It says, "But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, and you will go out and leap like calves released from the stall." So we already talked about the wicked, now the scripture talks about those who revere the name of God. You see, the righteous are not self-designated. You don't count yourself amongst the righteous. The righteous are those who are devoted to the Lord. The quote-unquote good people will not be spared from God's wrath, for all are sinners before the holiness of God. Only those who put their faith, their trust, their hope in the Lord will be spared. And for them, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. Now, the people of God often crave justice, but God offers them first healing. For they too are infected with a sinful nature, and though forgiven by God, they still need to be remade in his image. We're told that when that happens, they will go out and leap like calves released from the stall. Farming metaphor may or may not work for you, whether or not you've ever been around cows, but I think you can picture it. When that healing is complete, when God's people are healed by the restoring power of his Spirit, and their sinful nature is no more, then they will experience what life was supposed to have been, what God intended us to be before human sin marred us. And on that day, the people of God will rejoice with a joy that is more pure and more powerful than anything they have ever known. We can't imagine what it will be like to live without the drag of temptation in our mind, without guilt, without fear, without sorrow, without pain. Even if you can't imagine that because you've never experienced it, you should be able to understand the desire to run and and jump for joy when all such things are no more. The day of the Lord's wrath is coming, but this day of joy too is on the way. Verse 3. Then you will trample down the wicked. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I do these things, says the Lord Almighty. It will be the Lord, not his people, who brings about the vindication of his justice. But that process will necessarily involve his people, as they will have been the victims of injustice at the hands of the wicked. Throughout the centuries, wickedness has been imperfectly punished, and righteousness has been insufficiently rewarded. But that will not always be the case. The day of the Lord will begin God's final assertion of his perfect justice, a justice that his mercy has delayed for many sinners, and a justice that his grace has accepted the vicarious payment of Jesus as satisfying. But it is also a justice that will not be denied. And so we continue with verse 4. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. In light of the certainty of that coming day of the Lord's justice, only a fool would neglect the guidebook which God has given his people, that is, the law of Moses, which details the actions which lead to reward and those which lead to punishment. It ought thus always be a priority among the people of God to help each other follow the law, to train up the next generation to honor God's law, and to share knowledge of God's moral guidance with a world sorely in need of such wisdom. For us, living in the church age, we know without doubt that our acceptance before God is on the basis of grace through faith, not from keeping the law. But we are still equally responsible as we are in the new covenant, as Israel was in the old covenant, to follow and obey the law of God. For God's law is timeless, derived from his holiness. Therefore, the people of God, whether they were Israel of old or the church today, are called to be a holy people. And that by definition must mean that they are morally upright, a people who embrace righteousness and reject wickedness. Now we're going to look a little bit about that question about when. Verse 5, see, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. The future day of the Lord is coming. It will be a day of justice, but God will not divulge to humanity when that day will begin. We do know that it will be after the return of the prophet Elijah. Elijah, along with only the patriarch Enoch, as far as we know, did not taste death. But he was taken up to heaven in a chariot of fire when his task as the prophet of God had been completed and Elisha had been chosen to succeed him. The unique method that God utilized regarding Elijah led to speculation that he would one day return at some climactic point in the future of Israel. Here the prophet Malachi predicts that Elijah's return will be connected to the great and dreadful day of the Lord. It will precede it. During his transfiguration, when the divine glory of Jesus was revealed to Peter and James and John, the three disciples saw Jesus speaking with Moses and Elijah. Then the disciples asked him, why then do the teachers of the law say that Elijah must come first? They had in mind Malachi's prediction. Jesus responded to that question by explaining, to be sure Elijah comes and will restore all things. But I tell you, Elijah has already come, and they did not recognize him, but have done him everything they wished. The next verse by Matthew is the commentary in his gospel that tells us that the disciples then knew that Jesus was talking about John the Baptist. So Elijah has already come in the person of John the Baptist. a metaphorical Elijah who prepared God's people for the arrival of the Messiah Jesus. It was future when Malachi said it. It was present when Jesus talked about it. And for us, it's the past. Elijah has already come. There is nothing then in prophecy that must still occur before the day of the Lord. In other words, while we continue to have no knowledge of when the end times will begin, they could, in theory, begin today. Or not for thousands of years. We have absolutely no idea. God has promised that the day will come. He has not promised or told us when. The mission of the Messiah was entirely successful. Death and sin have been dealt a fatal blow through the cross and the empty grave. The new covenant has been established. The Holy Spirit came at Pentecost and now indwells Christ. And now indwells Christ's bride, the church. Now only the return of the bridegroom Jesus in judgment to reign in glory is yet to come. The day will come when the Father says, "It's today." As much as God's people might long for that day of judgment, so that they can see rights done to them accounted for and see an end to suffering and death, that day will indeed be a great and dreadful time. For those aligned with evil will not submit to God's will of their own accord. They will fight against the return of the King, arraying themselves with Satan against the Son of God, and they will be destroyed by the hand of God. It's left to us to warn our fellow man, lest they persist against God and perish. The last verse of the book of Malachi is this, verse 6. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. Perhaps it's a bit depressing to end Malachi with talk of a curse, but it illustrates well the stark choice that God has laid before humanity. Knowing that the great and dreadful day of the Lord is coming, people can either repent, trust in God and begin to follow his law, or they can refuse and face his judgment. There's no third choice. Jesus has made a way of salvation possible. Those who refuse him have rejected the Son of God, and they will not find mercy from the Father by spurning the sacrifice of his Son. The future, while it remains a mystery to us in almost every way, has been revealed to us in one key aspect. We know for sure that a day of wrath that will bring about justice is coming. It's a certainty. History will one day end. The earth will be destroyed and remade anew. All those who continue in rebellion against God will be destroyed as the sun establishes his everlasting kingdom in righteousness and holiness. That day is closer today than it was yesterday. It'll be closer tomorrow. Each of us are one day closer each day to facing our Creator and answering for our choice to embrace Jesus or reject him. There's no time to waste, no reason to delay. So if you do not yet know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, today is the day to come to him in faith. If you already have put your trust and hope in him, today is the day to come to renew and strengthen that commitment, to live now in order to honor and please him. Because we know this for certain. Surely the day is coming, the great and dreadful day of the Lord.